In a neat little town they call Belfast, apprentice to trade I was bound. Oh, many an hour, sweet happiness, have I spent in that neat little town. But
the death toll in Northern Ireland in 1972 reached 467, more than three times the total for the three preceding years put together.
If Belfast is to bow to violence today, where will it be next year? Birmingham? Glasgow? London?
The police in Northern Ireland have used water cannon tonight as more petrol bombs and fireworks were thrown on the seventh night of violence on the streets of Belfast.
The disorder last night was at a scale that we have not seen in recent years in Belfast or further afield.
Ég fór fyrst til Norður Írlands vorið 2019. Á þeim tíma voru Bretar nýbúnir að segja sig út úr Evrópusambandinu og virtist megin áhyggjefni þeirra að vera í garð innflytjenda á eyjunni. Það sem ég fekk hins vegar að kynnast frá íbúum í Belfast var að eins og alltaf þá var stór hluti breska konungsveldisins hunsaður þegar kom að spurningum framtíð og pólitíska stefnur þegar kom að málefnum Skotlands, Wales og þá sérstaklega Norður Írland. Við teljum okkur vera þjóð stikkfrí frá öllum deilum utan strendur landsins en í aðeins 2 klukkutíma flugferð má finna land sem hefur í árhundruður þurft að glíma við styrjaldir og ofsóknir og það raunveruleiki sem lítið sem ekkert kenndur í skólum Íslands. Ég ákvað að fara aftur þangað til að kanna hvort eitthvað hefur breyst og hvernig framtíð landsins mun verða í kjölfar Brexit og COVID. Við heimsóttum Belfast þann 12. júlí sem þann tími sem allir mótmælendur landsins kom út á götur til að minnast sigur Vilhjálms af Óraníu yfir hinum kaþólska King James hinum öðrum við Boinánna árið 1690. Orusta sem enginn þar í landi hefur gleymt til dagsins í dag. En til þess að skilja hvað að gerast á Norður Írlandi þurfum við aðeins að spóla tilbaka og skilja sögu Írlands yfir höfuð og hingað ég kominn.
Við Íslendingar eigum nú oft til að segja að þegar það gott veður þá hvergi annars staðar betra að vera heldur en á Íslandi. Ja, ég myndi nú bara að segja það sama Írland. Við erum stödd hér í Dublin, höfuðborg Írlands, eða Dublin eins og við segjum á góður íslensku, þar sem að ferðin okkar byrjar. Vegna þess að til þess að betur skilja hvað að gerast á Norður Írlandi þá þurfum við líka að skilja sögu eyjunar. Þessi þjóð bæði aðdánaverð og æðisleg og með ríka sögu og menningu. En því miður þá hefur sú saga einkennst í gegnum aldirnar aðeins og mikið af stríðum, kúun og deilum sem eru bæði pólitískar og trúalegar. The pictures tell the story, this life had many shades. I'd wake up every morning and before I'd start each day I'd take a drag from last night's cigarette that smoldered in its tray. Down a little something and then be on my way.
Írland eitt af þeim löndum sem Íslendingar elska að ferðast til, hvort sem það ein stutt helgaferð, ferðalag til að kaupa jólagjafir eða bara til að kynnast nýri menningu. Við förum til Írlands með það að leiðaljósi að þeir eru alveg eins og við og við getum kynnst hvort öðru yfir ísköldum Guinness. Og ef rauninni sú, þá ættu við það minnsta að skilja aðeins betur sögulandsins og hvaðan hún kemur. Talið að árið 432 hafir heilagur Patrikur komið til Írlands og hafið að snúa íbúum til kristni. Hinn nýju trúabrauð mörkuðu endalok drúið hefðana. Írski fræðimenn lögðu stund á latnesk fræði og kristna guðfræði í klaustrunum sem blómstruðu á Írlandi á þessum tíma og stóðu reyndar framar öðrum evrópskum fræðimönnum í því að varðveita latínuna í gegnum hinnar myrku miðaldir. Þessari gull öld lauk með innrásum víkinga sem hófust á 9. öld og stóðu í það bil 200 ár. Víkingarnir rændu klaustur og bæi og stofnuðu marga bæi á ströndum Írlands. Ár 1172 sölsaði Hinrik annar Englandskonungur undir sig írsk lönd og á 13. öld var farið að innleiða ensk lög. Ítök Englendinga náðu í fyrstu einungis til svæðisins í kringum Dublin eða Dublin sem þá gekk undir nafninu Pali en tóku að breiðast út á 16. öld og við lok þeirra 17. var hið gelíska samfélag liðið undir lok. Á miðri 19. öld reið kartöfluhungursneyðin mikla yfir eyjuna. Aðgerðaleysi stjórnvalda gagnvart þessari kreppu leiddi til þess að milljónir sultu og mikill fjöldi flutti úr landi til Bretlands, Norður-Ameríku og Ástralíu.
Frá árunum 1845 til 1852 geisaði rosalega mikil hungursneyð yfir írsku þjóðuna. Hátt í milljón manns létust annaðhvort úr hungri eða úr öðrum sjúkdómum sem tengdust hungrinum. Það var einnig mikið fólksflótta héðan og margir írar lögðu í skip sem kölluðust á þeim tíma coffin ships eða líkistu bátar sem átti að ferja þá yfir til Bandaríkjanna í vonum betra líf.
Íbúafjöldi eyjunar hrapaði úr 8 milljónum fyrir hungursneyðina niður í 4,4 milljónir árið 1911.
Hungrið var í raunin svo slæmt að margir í hérna á Írlandi létu einfaldlega handtaka sig viljandi og til að geta verið sendir hérna inn í kilmeinum gálfangelsið þar sem þeir vissu að allavega þar inni beið að minnstu kosti ein brauðsneið handa þeim.
Ensk áhrif héldu áfram að breiðast út og enska var útbreiddasta tungumálið. En á sama tíma tók að bera á háværari röddum aðskilnað frá breskum stjórnvöldum og sjálfstæði Írlands. Árið 1922 í kjölfar írska sjálfstæðistríðsins sem stóð frá 1919 til 1921 var írska fríríkið stofnað. Þing Norður Írlands, þar sem mótmælendur voru í meiri hluta, nýtti sér þá möguleika til að segja sig úr hinu nýja ríki og var sérstök eining innan breska konungsdæmisins. Írska fríríkið var í fyrstu hluti af breska samveldinu en árið 1949 voru skyldur konungs afnumdar í írskum lögum og landið varð lýðveldi. Írska lýðveldið var lengi vel eitt af fátækustu ríkjum Evrópu. Landið gekk í Evrópusambandið árið 1973 og seint á 9. áratug 20. aldar hófust efnahagslegar umbætur í anda frjálshyggju sem leiddu til ört vaxandi hagsældar.
Það eru fáir hlutir í þessum heimi sem eru jafn írskir og eitt ískaldur Guinness á dælu. Þó svo við getum auðvitað að fengið Guinness heim á Íslandi þá ekkert leyndamál að hann allt öðruvísi hér í Dublin. Og þess vegna hef ég komið til höfuðstöðvar Guinness til þess að læra meira sögu bjórsins, hvaðan hann kemur og hvernig hann smakkast.
Thank you, my man. How are we doing, buddy?
Very good, how are you?
Very good, good, good. Come on in, let's go. Ready for all things Guinness?
Absolutely.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I think let's have a good day.
So we're standing here right next to the, 9,000 year lease, is it?
Yeah,
what,
this is...
That's, I mean, you think 9,000 years back, that's hunter-gatherer society. What's the point of having such a lengthy timeline?
Yeah, but, well, what we would say about Arthur, the guy who started it all, Arthur Guinness, is he was a man of vision and a man of, you know, dedication to his craft. He was born into a brewing family, like, so his father was also a brewer. He inherited some money from the family and he came here and he signed a lease for a brewery that was in existence for £45 a year for 9,000 years, which is crazy, like if we think about it,
yeah.
This lease would technically expire in the year 10,059, you know, like when Arthur was brewing in 1759, it would take 20 liters of water just to make 1 liter of beer. So as you can imagine, that could have been a massive expense, you know, if you had to pay for the water rates. So within the lease, the water came for free. So Arthur signed the lease also for the longest period he possibly could to ensure that he would always have that resource available for him. Now, don't worry, I know 20 sounds like a lot. We're a lot more environmentally sustainable now. We'd use about 3 liters of water for every liter of beer, and we recycle the water as much as possible to make sure we don't waste it.
So for people who aren't really into beer or don't know much about it, what is the, you know, the brewing process of it? What makes Guinness different from, say, like a traditional lager?
Yeah, it's actually, and it is. It's right in the brewing process, and this is where we're going to go and we're going to see. Because the one thing that stands Guinness out from most other beers, actually, and it's quite noticeable, it's the colour. When you look at Guinness straight away, it looks unique versus every other beer. It's dark in colour, whereas most of our beers are light, amber, golden. And that's because what we do is that barley that we use to make the beer, well, 10% of it is actually roasted. So we roast our barley to 232 degrees Celsius, much like coffee beans are roasted. And what happens is then the barley changes colour and it changes its flavour compounds. And when we add that into the brew, it turns the beer dark. You get a colour transfer from this dark barley, it changes the liquid dark, and then the barley's roasted like coffee, so this kind of toasty, coffee-like, you know, rich, roasty qualities, they transfer into the beer. And that's what makes Guinness, you know, that's one of the main things that makes Guinness unique from most other beers. So our beer was available globally and bringing up loads of popularity without ever having been advertised. So it was just purely the strength of the product and word of mouth that sold it all around the world. So eventually though, you know, we had to advertise. So in 1929, we took out our first ever advert. It was a full page press advert in the UK, and it's actually just down here. And so this was our first ever advert that we took out in the year 1929. So the company's in operation for well over 100, you know, 60 odd years, and then we advertised. Now, you do have to remember it was 1929 and advertising standards were a lot different than they are now, because we went with a very interesting expression in saying Guinness is good for you.
Maybe good for your for some aspects of yourself.
Yeah, well, now listen, I work for a very big drinks company and it is 2022, so I will categorically state Guinness is not good for you. It is alcohol. Excessive consumption of alcohol is bad. However, in 1929, the legislation was quite different, and at the time was quite different.
I was interested in all the animals, the toucans, you know, where does all that come from?
But here we are. This is the wonderful world of the Guinness animals. It was this man here, John Gilroy. So he was a famous portrait artist that we'd hired for our next campaign. And he had recently been to the zoo and was inspired by all the animals he saw. So he drew himself as the zookeeper, and the animals would be a bit cheeky, you know, a little bit playful, and they'd all be robbing his Guinness and running off with it, and he'd have to chase after. And it was very, like, this is, you know, like the kind of coming into the like 1950s, and our very simple time for advertising, you know, like each of the animals had a little jingle that would help sell it.
Okay.
I suppose our most famous is the toucan.
So
that was actually a play on the word toucan. If he can say as you can, Guinness is good for you, how grand to be a toucan, just think what two can do.
Oh.
So that's why you'd often see the toucan pictured with two pints of Guinness, because it was a play on the word.
So I keep hearing that there's several steps. You can't just pour a pint of Guinness and just, you know,
No. This is an art, my friend. This is a skill. And I'm going to teach you this life skill now. So you can go back to Iceland now and you can show all your friends the proper way to pour a Guinness draft, okay?
Absolutely.
We do it in a two-part pour. Basically, we take our Guinness branded glass, and what we're going to do is we're going to fill it up to the top of the gold harp, and we're going to leave it up on the bar to rest, right? And this is what we call the Guinness surge or settle. And I'll explain what's going to happen then. And then once our surge is complete, what we're going to do then is we're going to fill it all the way up to the top, all right?
Okay.
So what we like to do is we take our Guinness glass, the shape actually helps, and the beer comes out here. So we like to hold it at a 45 degree angle. And what we do is we pull our tap handle all the way down. As the beer kind of fills the glass, we slowly straighten it. And as soon as our beer hits that gold harp, we're going to put it up on the bar to settle. And this is the first of our two-part pour. So what I want you to pay attention to now, right, is if we notice the head of the beer is very, very, very skinny, almost non-existent.
Right.
And it looks like there's stuff falling down the side of the glass. So what's happening right now, my friend, is inside that glass of Guinness, there are 30 million bubbles of nitrogen trying to escape. Okay?
Amazing.
Yeah, so all those bubbles of nitrogen are shooting up through the liquid and they're getting caught up in the liquid, and that's what forms the creamy head. So you can notice that the head of the beer has started to thicken up as the beer has started to settle. Now, there's 30 million bubbles trying to get out and they're shooting up the center of the pint. They don't all get out at the same time. So what happens is as some of them hit the top, they get pushed to the side and then they get caught up in what we call a gravity loop, and they're forced back down the side of the glass. So what we see here cascading down is just nitrogen gas bubbles that are moving up and around, up and around, up and around, until all those gas bubbles have escaped And that's what forms that beautiful creamy head on the Guinness. What we're also doing is we're playing off that anticipation. Good things come to those who wait. We make you wait for that Guinness, for that perfect head to develop, and now it has. So it's time to fill it up. You know, we want our value, okay? So this time, what we're gonna do is we're not gonna pull the handle toward us, we're gonna push it away. And it limits the amount of gas and pressure that goes in the second time so that we don't have to wait as long for it to settle. So we hold it directly below the nozzle, push the handle towards the customer, and we fill it up so a little bit of the pint pops out of the top in that beautiful, smooth, creamy dome. We serve it with the logo facing forward, and that, my friend, should be the perfect pint of Guinness. From when I start to pour till I serve it to you, should take 119.5
seconds. 0.5
seconds. Exactly, yeah, yeah. And that is the perfect pint, okay? Let's see how you get on, okay?
All right.
So yeah, we're gonna put your logo facing away, yeah? Bring the bottom, exactly. And then bring your handle all the way down. Don't forget to smile, come on. Lovely. Now we're slowly straightening our glass. And then when it hits the top of the gold harp, just back upright. Perfect. Beautiful. And up on the bar for our settle. So like we say, look, you see what's happening already?
Mm-hmm.
You're drawn in. It's such an aesthetic, like, pleasing point. You can't help but look.
It's like a lava lamp.
Yeah, it really is. It's poetry in a glass. I've heard it referred to.
I like yours better.
Now, well, it looks like our Guinness is ready. We've lovely and dark, lovely foamy head on top. So, like I said, we're ready to fill it up this time, Helgi. So, we push towards the customer. And we want to fill up so a little bit pops over the top. Oh, a little bit. There we go. Oh, that is beautiful. Logo facing forward. Ah, you've done this before. And that, my friend, is the perfect pint of Guinness. The shape of the glass affects the beer. Like, you'd think this is going to spill everywhere. You know, it's so full, it's ridiculous. But the tulip shape of the glass, it means that when it rises above it, it's kind of leaning in on itself, which increases the surface tension, which means you can actually be quite robust with your pint of Guinness before it's going to spill anywhere. So you can rest assured.
I've never dared to do that.
Yeah, you'll make it from
I don't want to be
let's try it. Let's be brave, right? It means that you'll make it right down to the table without spilling a drop.
Well, see, it's because I don't want to spill it that I've never dared to do this.
Yeah. That's it. That's where the shape of the glass kind of helps as well.
And the shower, though.
And yeah, like, it's not a fake point. It will eventually spill, like, you know.
Right,
yeah. They're not rubber.
Then you know,
they taste better when you've made them yourself, my friends.
Shall we give it a try?
Ah, slantje.
Let's go.
Putting your new skills to use.
Are you guys hiring?
Fun you feel grimly here. Call the reeve knock me in heart. Down to some cobble there, I'm scared. Achtamir Manakar.
Írland er ekki bara önnur enskumælandi þjóð. Þetta er þjóð sem var og ennþá með sitt eigið tungumál. Írska. Einnig þekkt sem gelíska eða írsk-gelíska. Hún ekki alls ráðandi á eyjunni en samt mikið töluð á vesturströnd Írlands, sérstaklega í kringum Galway. Margir Írar bera að sjálfsögðu mikla hlýju til tungu sinnar og menningu og vilja augljóslega reyna að halda henni lifandi. Skiltin á Írlandi eru til dæmis bæði á ensku og írsku og írska eitt af 23 opinberum tungumálum Evrópusambandsins.
And so take us a little bit through the history of, I mean, Ireland obviously being colonized in the 12th century.
Yep. Well, now there were some Scandinavians who brought with them old Icelandic and they did it.
The name Ireland actually does come from the Vikings, the combination of Ir and land.
Oh yeah, and plenty of places around this area of the island.
Dublin was also founded by the Vikings. So.
It was indeed. Yeah. Thank you very much for that.
and in
Irish, actually, we owe old Icelandic a debt because we get quite a few words. Not a huge amount, given how many centuries we were interacting with Vikings. Nice diplomatic words Viking settlements in Ireland. But a lot of words in the Irish language for boats, equipment, anything to do with sailing, trade, fish and things like that. A lot of them come from Old Icelandic. So our word for penny, pingin. Market is, today it's marga. The Irish language has kept changing, but margadur, I believe, stress here.
Wow.
Trusk is our word for cod, again, we're told. Anyway, that comes from old Icelandic. And stuer, rudder.
So,
we owe quite a debt to the likes. But yeah, Ireland was colonised from Britain in the 12th century. And that brought the English language. Initially, it also brought French and probably a bit of Welsh and Flemish, but English hung around in some areas anyway. The Irish language itself, we can't really be sure how long it's actually been spoken in Ireland or indeed anywhere else, because we're reliant on written documentation. We don't have written documentation until the 5th century.
En það er ekki bara Írar sem hafa fengið mikið af orðum sínum frá Íslendingum. Mörg íslensk mannanöfn eru tekin úr írsku og þar sem margir landnámsmenn komu frá Írlandi, Skotlandi og öðrum hlutum Bretlandseyja. Nöfn eins og Brjánn, Kjartan, Kormákur, Melkorka og Njáll koma öll úr írsku.
We have a very, very old history. We have writing going back to the 5th century. We have manuscripts going back to the 7th century. And then along the 12th century comes the Normans, bringing with them French and English. And just like Icelandic, that gave us loads of new words. Among other things, you can focus on the politics and the murdering and the land being stolen and all these other interesting things. Or you can just look at the borrowed words. But in the dialect of Irish that I speak, for example, we have the word garçon for boy, just garçon from French. So you can see the history reflected in the words that were borrowed from, or poche, page in English is another borrowing from French again for a kid, a page in English.
En spurningin hvernig byrjaði þetta allt saman? Sko, Norður-Írland í rauninni var ekki alltaf til, eins og Englendingar áttu svo oft til að gera á sínu tíma.
Þá byrjuðu að hertaka eyjuna á 12. öld undir Hinriki Englandskonungs. Og árið 1801 þá var Írland orðið formlega hluti af breska konungsveldinu.
En í millitíðinu höfðu átt sér stað margar trúarlega breytingar sem myndu vera uppspretta allra þeirra deilna sem við sjáum hér í dag.
Á 16. og 17. öld áttu sér stað siðaskipti eða trúskipti í nokkrum kristnum löndum í Evrópu. Fram til þessa hafði álfan verið meira og minna kaþólsk en háværa raddir fóru að heyrast frá umbótasinnum eins og Martin Luther sem vildi siðbót innan kirkjunar og barðist meðal annars gegn sölu aflátsbréfa sem notuð voru til að fjármagna framkvæmdir í Róm. Á sama tíma í Englandi voru ensku siðaskiptin einnig að eiga sér stað sem leiddi til stofnunar ensku biskupakirkjunar sem gerði fyrst og fremst Englandskonung höfuð kirkjunar í stað páfa. Sá sem stóð á bak við þessa breytingu var Hinrik VIII Englandskonungur. Á þeim tíma vildi Hinrik skilja við konu sína, Katrínu af Aragon, svo hann geti gifst annari konu, henni Önnu Boleyn. Hann hafði reynt að fá páfan til að ógilda hjónabandi við Katrínu en það vildi páfin ekki gera. Afleiðing þessara deilna var sú að Hinrik sleit tengsl ensku kirkjunar við páfan og gerði sjálfur höfuð kirkjunar. Hann lét fjarlægja allt sem hét kaþólst í landinu og neytti alla heimamenn til að skipta yfir og gerast mótmælendatrúar. Það fór reyndar ekki vel í kaþólsku dóttur hans, hana Maríu eða blóðugu Maríu eins og sagan hefur kallað hana og eftir dauða Hinriks reyndi hún að endurheimta kaþólsku kirkjuna með því að snúa við öllum breytingum föður síns en deyr svo árið 1558. Hálfsystir hennar, Elisabeth, tekur svo við af henni og biður Englendinga að gerast aftur mótmælendur. Ensku siðaskiptin stóðu raun yfir til ársins 1690 þegar orustan við Boinána átti sér stað. Hinn hollenski Vilhjálmur af Óraníu hafði nýlega verið krýndur Englandskonungur og árið 1688 hafði kaþólski frændi hans, hinn óvinsæli James konungur, hinn annar verið sendur í útlegð. Hann flúði til Frakklands og fékk aðstoð frá Lóðvík 14. Sem hataði Vilhjálm, til að senda her til Írlands þar sem frændinni tveir myndu mætast í orustu við Boinána í Dublin þann 1. júli 1690. Her Williams hafði betur í þeirri orustu og flúði James aftur til Frakklands. Og eftir þessa orustu hefur til dagsins í dag engin kaþólskur konungur ráðið yfir Bretlandseyjum.
Alveg frá því að kristintaka átti sér stað á Írlandi á 5. öld, þá hafa Írar mest megnis verið kaþólskir. fyrir utan eitt svæði í norðausturhlutanum, Ulster.
Og það engin tilviljun. Alveg frá 17. öld þá byrjuðu Englandskonungar að flytja inn sitt eigið fólk á svæðið
sem voru mest megnis mótmælendur frá Skotlandi og Englandi með þaðan eina tilgang að hollustuvæða svæðið. Þannig að hér byggi fólk sem að voru allir hliðhollir Englandskonungi en á meðan voru kaþólskir litnir á sem bara hornsteinn í augum Englandskonungs.
Norður-Írland hefur verið skipt í tvær fylkingar í mörg hundru ár. En eftir stríðsárin fóru margar breytingar að eiga sér stað. 1960 fóru írskir þjóðernissinnar að krefjast umbætur sem fóru ekki vel í strangtrúaða sambandsinna. Þjóðernissinnar enduðu á því að stofna samtök borgarlegra réttinda og voru umræður varandi umbætur á milli beggja hliða mjög friðsamlegar. Til að byrja með. Árið 1968 spruttu upp mótmæli víðsvegar heiminn. Bandaríkjamenn byrjuðu að mótmæla stríðinu í Víetnam, það var mótmælt í París, Mexíkó, Berlín. Það var bara eins og allur heimurum var við það að springa. Og á Norður-Írlandi fóru að eiga sér stað miklar óeirðir sem endaði með því að breski herinn var kallaður inn til að reyna stilla til friðar. Margir þjóðernissinnar voru við fyrstu mjög ánægðir að fá herinn inn í landið þar sem óvinurinn þar á þeim tíma var ekki breski herinn, heldur lögreglan og aðrir heimamenn sem mismunuðu þeim. En eftir árin liðu var það orðið augljóst að herinn var þangað kominn til að tryggja breska fótsetu í landinu og bæla niður það sem þau skilgreindu sem hryðjuverk og aðskilnaðastefnu.
Á 7. og 8. áratug seinustu aldar þurftu kaþólskir íbúar á Norður-Írlandi að lifa við mikla kúun. Bara sem dæmi, á árunum 1922 til 1972 var borgin Derry aldrei með kaþólskan borgarstjóra, þrátt fyrir það að íbúar borgarinnar voru kaþólikkar í yfirgnæfandi meirihluta. Kaþólskir íbúar áttu svo sannarlega ekki 7 dagana sæla og fengu mikinn innblástur frá bandarísku mannréttindahetjunni Martin Luther King. Á þessum tíma var hann leiðtogi borgarlegra réttinda fyrir blökkumenn í Bandaríkjunum og sáu margir kaþólikkar á Norður-Írlandi hliðstæður við baráttu hans og þeirra. Kaþólskir íbúar byrjuðu að halda sín eigin kröfugöngur og börðust fyrir svipum réttindum og nágranna þeirra sem voru af mótmælendatrú. Þeir vildu einungis búa við jafnrétti.
7. áratuginn voru kaþólskir íbúar á Norður-Írlandi í frekar leiðilegri stöðu. Þeir voru í raun skilgreindir sem annars flokks íbúar í eigin landi og var borgin Derry örugglega besta dæmi það. Kaþólskir íbúar höfðu verið í meirihluta í þessari borg en hún var hins vegar stjórnuð af mótmælendum í marga áratugi. Kaþólikkar gátu ekki keypt íbúðir, þeim var neitað vinnu og ofan á það þurftu þeir að lifa við mikla kúun frá breskum hersveitum. Samband sem myndi ná suðupunkti 30. janúar 1972, betur þekkt sem blóðu í sunnudagurinn.
Voðaverkin í Derry hafa verið nefnd blóðu í sunnudagurinn eða Bloody Sunday. Þennan dag fóru þúsundir borgarbúa í mótmælagöngu Bogside hverfið og kröfðust mannréttinda kaþólskum norður-írum til handa. Sumar heimildir herma að alltaf 30.000 manns hafi verið í göngunni, en samkvæmt öðrum heimildum voru þeir á bilinu 3-5.000. Allt fóru böndunum hins vegar þegar fallegar hermenn sem höfðu verið sendir frá Belfast til Derry skutu á göngufólkið. 13 létu samstundis og sá 14 nokkru setna af sárum sínum. Flestir voru þeir eða undir tvítugu. Hátt í 30 urðu fyrir skotum. Hermennir héldu því fram að þeir hefðu gripið til vopna til að verja hendur sínar því að skotið hafði verið á þá. Þessum mótmæltu göngumenn og blaða og fréttamenn sem voru sjónavottar af voðaverkunum. Hart var tekist á málið næstu árin og áratugina þar á eftir. Það var í loks janúar 1998 sem Tony Blair, þáverandi forsætisráðherra Bretlands, skipaði rannsóknarnefnd sem skyldi fara vandlega í saumana á málinu. 12 árum síðan var skýrsla loksins gerð opinber sem fjallaði málið og var hún þá orðin svo umfangsmesta og dýrasta í sögu landsins og kostaði hún hátt í 200 milljónir punda. Og niðurstaðan var afgerandi. Ekkert benti til þess að göngumenn höfðu ógnað hermönnunum þannig að þeir höfðu þurft að verja hendur sínar og drepa saklausa borgara.
Some members of our armed forces acted wrongly. The government is ultimately responsible for the conduct of the armed forces, and for that, on behalf of the government, Indeed, on behalf of our country, I am deeply sorry.
Það góð ástæð fyrir því að margir eiga það til að líta björtum augum á framtíð Norður-Írlands. Þrátt fyrir fleiri hundruð ára deilu á milli trúarhópa og stríð sem reiði yfir í áratugi, þá almenningur einfaldlega komið með nóg. Breska ríkisstjórnin reyndi, eins og við sáum þarna, að viðurkenna mistök sín og talsmenn beggja hliða unnu í mörg ára því að stilla til friðar á milli stríðandi fylkinga. Árið 1998 náði friðaferlið hátindi sínum með undirritun á hinum svokallaða föstudagssáttmála eða The Good Friday Agreement. Þá mættust bæði ríkisstjórnir Írlands og Bretlands í Belfast á föstudeginum langa og sættust á mörg atriði sem höfðu klofið samfélagið árum saman. Írska ríkisstjórnin viðurkenndi þá formlega í fyrsta skipti að Norður-Írland væri hluti af Bretlandi og Bretar viðurkenndu að löngun margra íbúa í norðurhlutanum til að sameinast Írlandi væri ekki byggt á aðskilnaðastefnu, heldur væri raun lögmætt viðhorf. Norður-Írland myndi þá vera hluti af Bretlandi en skildi meiri hluti íbúa í framtíðinni kjósa að fara í hináttina og sameinast Írlandi þá þyrftu bæði ríkisstjórnir að virða þá ósk. Sáttmálinn veitti Norður Írum heimastjórn og í kjölfar hófst mikið afvopnunarferli og umbætur á löggæslu landsins. Föstudagssáttmálinn batt enda á 3 áratuga löngu stríði á Norður Írlandi sem hafði orðið 3500 manns að bana. Til að betur skilja þessa myrku sögu Belfast og Norður Írlands fengum við leigubílstjóran Jimbo til að sýna okkur hverfin og veggina sem skilja á milli mótmælendur og kaþólika.
All right, Jim, how you doing?
Nice meeting.
Nice meeting. Yeah.
Welcome to Belfast.
Thank you so much for that.
So you're looking at a bit of a taxi tour then around Belfast?
Absolutely, yeah. You're going to show us around the murals and give a little history into the troubles and the history of your country.
And I'll bring you up one side, bring in the Shankill side, and I'll bring you over and through the other side on the Falls Road, Celtic side, Bombay Street and things like that there to give you an idea what we suffered back in the troubles.
Well, smash it. Let's get started.
Not a problem. The Regina Campbell was a Protestant woman who married a Catholic fella.
That was her only crime?
They had 10 kids, would it? And the husband died young, and she was still raising, bringing her kids up as, I mean, Catholics. Her crime was she actually brought tea out to London and stand talking to a soldier out in London. And someone had spotted her, accused her of Protestant information.
So with 10 kids, they thought it might be a good idea to disappear the mother. The hopes that their kids are not going to be taking up arms against whoever was responsible for that?
Yeah, do you mean the kids were crying? Do you mean they brought the sons downstairs to the car? But as soon as they got Jean into the car, they basically turned around and told the kids to go back in again. And I'm being polite in certain things, what I've heard, I don't know the full story of it. But there is a nice wee book, or do you mean what the son has wrote? It's called Saying That, would it? And it tells you all about what happened on that day. You could get a wee bit more information from the book itself, would it? Do you mean they even accused Gina Campbell of doing moss coat with their blinds?
Wow.
On an army camp what was on North Hart Street, would it? I don't know. This is all the rumours which you've heard from it.
Konan sem hann að tala Jean McConville og hún örugglega besta dæmið það hversu virkilega hrottalegt þetta stríð var. Jean fæddist inn í mótmælendafjölskyldu en varð kaþóliki eftir að hún giftist fyrrum kaþólskum hermanni og áttu þau saman 10 börn. Fjölskyldan neyddist til að flytja í Divis-blokkirnar eftir að þeim var bolað út úr mótmælendahverfi sínu og lést maðurinn hennar úr krabbameini í janúar 1972. Nokkrum mánuðum fyrir andlát hennar mynduðust deilur á milli Jean McConville og nágranna hennar sem ásökuðu hana að veita mikilvægar upplýsingar til breska hersins og var hún þá grunuð að vera uppljóstrari eða informant. Þeir einstaklingar sem stunduðu slíkt í gegnum stríðsárin voru samstundis tekin af lífi. Kvöld eitt var hún rænd af heimili sínu þar sem hún sat ein heima með börnin sín 10 og skotin í hnakkan. Lík hennar var svo grafið ofan í strönd við landamæri Írlands í 80 km fjarlægð frá heimilinnar. Öll stríð eru vissulega óhugnanleg en það sem gerðist á Norður Írlandi var miskunnarlaust. Stríðið leit meira út eins og húskallavíin úr njálu. Ef einhver úr einu liði var drepinn þá var hefnt fyrir það daginn eftir. Það skipti engu máli hvort sá aðili tengdist fyrir að morðinu eða ekki, svo lengi sem þeir voru annarkort kaþóliki eða mótmælendi.
You see the grey metal fence and the black wheels away in the distance there. And even though it means just for about half a mile, there is no wall, there's no barriers, this division starts at that gate and finishes up that mountain.
And it was extended up that mountain about 12, 13 years ago now. It's like most of the divisions from the Good Friday Agreement, they've all been made higher. And that's when they've been named the Peace Walls.
Kind of an ironic name.
Í gegnum söguna þá hefur það reynst ríkisstjórnum vel að skilja að stríðandi fylkingar með því að byggja múra. Hvort sem það var Kínamúrin á 14. öld eða Berlínamúrin á tímum kaldastrísins, þá virðist aðskilnaður alltaf vera auðveldari lausn en að stilla til friðar og Belfast engin undantekning. Þegar vandræðin byrjuði í Belfast seint á 7. áratug seinustu aldar ákvaða breska ríkisstjórnin að byggja upp veggi á milli kaþólsku hverfin og þau hverfi sem voru af mótmælendatrú. Upprunalega átti þetta ekki að vera varanleg áætlun en þar sem þetta virtist virka svo vel þá urðu veggirnir bara hærri eftir því sem árin liðu og núna einkenna þessir múrar borgina Belfast.
So we're standing here honestly by the ironically nicknamed Peace Walls. So these were put up during the start of the Troubles, but because of their effectiveness, they just got higher and higher.
Well, you can see by the corrugated iron here, what's on the left-hand side of it. Do you mean, okay, it started off with the people when they're barricading themselves in. Do you mean when the army came in, they started racking things like this? Do you mean it was the early part of the 70s when it started off and then the concrete, what you can see here now. But this here was modified three times. You see the way the road is, widened here. I mean, this was 1981, mm-hmm. 81 when this road was widened. It was also in the 80s when these houses was built. So even though you see the blue fence, on one side and the wall on the other side, the two of them is a divide. So no one gets any close to the wall.
Stærsti múrin skilur að tvær götur, Falls Road, sem hýsir kaþólika, og Shankill Road, þar sem mótmælendur búa. Þessar tvær götur virka nokkurn veginn sem laugarvegir beggja hliða og fer ekki á milli mála hvor megin þú ert þegar þú gengur þar
As we see, we're standing at the divide between Shankill Road and the Falls Road. But the gates here, these will be closed by 5:30 tonight. Do you mean it's the second and third gate will be closed at 6:30 every night? And the fourth one now will be closed at 10 o'clock. And they will stay closed right through the night till the next morning. As I said, it all started off as division between the two religions. But it also turned into the sense where it was cutting down the manpower of the British Army. Because they didn't have the man control this area as what they used to, when it was just the corrugated iron or the people themselves would have to barricade. But you see the thickness of these. I say these here are probably three times as thick as what the last gates was. The other ones would have had spikes on it, pointing spikes with bad wire wrapper in it, with them it's actually rotating.
Ég veit að það kannski erfitt fyrir okkur á Íslandi að skilja hvernig lífið fyrir fólkið í Belfast, þannig skulum reyna að búa til ákveðna mynd. Segjum sem svo að Reykjavík skipt í tvennt, kaþólikar og mótmælendur. Flestir kaþólikar búa í Breiðholti, Árbæ og Kópavogi. Það búa nokkrir í Fossvoginu, en bærin skiptist á við Grensásveg þar sem mótmælendur taka við og búa í Hlíðunum, Miðbænum og út á Seltatanesi. En málið að þetta ekki svona einfalt. Þeir kaþólsku íbúar sem snerta Fossvogin eru í það miklum deilum við þá íbúa sem eru mótmælendur að 10 metra hátt hlið sem skilur á milli hverfin við Grensás þarf að loka hvert einasta kvöld klukkan 6. Hins vegar við nýbýlaveg, þeir kaþólsku íbúar sem búa við Bíkó og þeir mótmælendur sem búa rétt hjá American Style eru aðeins betri hvort við annað þannig að það hlið má loka 8. Og víðs vegar Reykjavík búa kaþólikar og mótmælendur hlið við hlið án þess að hafa vegg á milli sín og það eina sem skilur þá að hvernig bar fólk sækir og börnin þeirra að fara öll í skóla samkvæmt sinni trú. Þetta raunveruleiki sem að nútíma Evrópuþjóð þarf að glíma við hvern einasta dag.
So there's not going to be like a Berlin Wall situation where, you know, they just knock it down and happy days and...
As I said earlier on, there was a group set up in the government way back in the early 2000s, and they set a date for all these walls to come down. Mm. No one has heard anything from this group. It was actually a conference that was held in the waterfront a few years back before COVID. I do believe that forced... a questionnaire was sent out to the people. I don't mean a questionnaire was sent out to people two or three streets away.
Right.
It was questionnaires sent out to the people who live beside these walls. And that was basically asking them what they thought about the walls, would they like to see the walls down. The majority of that, and I'm not too sure of percentage, but most of them voted for the walls to remain at the present minute.
Just because it brings some security, it's like a safety blanket.
It's a safety blanket. Mm. But they knew it's too soon. Mm-hmm. And that's what I said, another part of that question, would they like to see the walls down and when would they like to see the walls down?
Mm-hmm.
And most of them voted to see, they would like to see the walls down before their grandchildren.
Well,
so there is a will, there is a will to move on, but does that say that's going to be the wee trigger point?
Yeah.
because no one wants to sit and have to worry about things.
Because once the walls are down, that's it. And even
our government wouldn't like to make that decision just in case something did happen. Do you mean if the walls came down in afterwards? Because it would fall back onto the Emirates. That's why they're basically just letting it sit the way it actually is. Because they say that will be the people themselves decide that when these come down, we know we're in 100% peace. But till then, I do believe the walls will remain, because it's embedded in people. It's that safety blanket what we're just out there talking about. And you know yourself, you have one enemy cover blanket when you were young, it's hard to get rid of it.
That's true, that's a very good point.
Yeah, I'm just getting the girders.
The
girders. What did you call it? The conservatory.
The Belfast conservatory.
The Belfast conservatory. Perfect. It's just the way that people, like, you know, bring humour to the grimmest situations is always fascinating to me.
They kind of have to. I mean, there's
you have to laugh at things. Things shouldn't be taken seriously anymore.
Thank you so much for that, Connor. Thank you for making Northern Irish politics sound like a Monty Python sketch.
I used to do material about, it was only a matter of time. You know, American soldiers in Vietnam?
Yeah.
And now they're all starting to go back to Vietnam. Ex-GIs. Seemingly, ex-British soldiers have now started to come back to Belfast on tour. Yes, they are visiting Belfast to get tours of the places they used to actually serve. And who is giving tour guides? Ex-IRA members are acting as the tour guides. I'm not making this up. What I'm telling you, can you imagine what that's going to be? Right, lads, all stay together here now, fellas. Okay, don't wander off. Peace is array, but don't take the piss here, okay? Now, we're at the bottom of New Lodge Road, North Queen Street, a very very hot spot in the 70s and 80s, and some squaddy's going to go, oh, yeah, I remember somebody tried to shoot me here. Is that right? Oh, when was that? 1971. Good month. March the 22nd. March of 27! Is that me? That's me! You're kidding me! 80 odds! 80 odds of me and you! I'm telling you, you're looking at a few pigs in here!
I was actually told by the bar staff, just to make an announcement before I start this, whoever left the backpack unattended in the corner there, please pick it up. Sound is making him nervous. I don't know who belongs. It says Sarah Ladd or Sarah. I don't know how you guys pronounce that.
I was in Belfast, Northern Ireland. Got talking to this guy. Starts telling me all his political opinions, right? And I don't really care what you are, right? But he happened to be a big DUP voting loyalist unionist guy in Northern Ireland. Then he starts telling me his opinions about the trans community. I'm like, oh, here we go. This will be illuminating. That's what he said to me. He said, I don't like these trans people. If you're physically a man, how can you identify as a woman? And I was like, well, to be fair, mate, I mean, Northern Ireland is physically part of Ireland. You don't seem to have a problem with that identifying as part of Great Britain. I mean, really, there should be no one more pro-trans than a Northern Irish unionist. This guy's saying to me, he's like, these trans people, they're called one name and then expect you to call them another. It's like, what do you mean, like Derry in Londonderry?
So why are you going to Northern Ireland? I mean, like, there's no war going on there. I'm like, give it a second. I was like, man, I have to, like, explain to her, like, really what happened. And I had to explain it in the most simplest terms I could. And I'm like, okay, so it's essentially two different types of white people who hate each other because one side doesn't attend the church that the other side doesn't go to in the first place. Like, that's really silly. I'm like, but there's history. Man, there was a battle that took place that kind of really divided the two sides. Like, oh, recently? 332 years ago. I was just like, well, that's, wait, so some Irish guy led up, no, he was Dutch, actually. He's like, why are they fighting? Like, I don't know! And I don't think they do either. Look, COVID just happened, they're bored, you know. All I know is that I was supposed to wear a fucking stab vest when I'm covering the 12th because petrol bombs might go off next to Tesco.
Say this year is the 11th of July and tomorrow is the 12th.
And this is the biggest, 12th of July will be the biggest celebration straight away of the Protestant community, the Orange Order. And this, as I say, all dates back to the 12th of July 1690 with the Battle of the Boyne with King William III and King James II. But these bonfires here will be lit 1 minute past midnight, but tonight, going into the 12th of July. And that's basically commemorate the beacons which led King William III till the Boyne on that battle.
Hverju árið þann 11. júlí hópast þúsundir mótmælenda hér á Norður Írlandi í kringum þessa slíkar brennur þar sem að fólk Hey guys, come on in. You guys are be on Icelandic Netflix, right?
Okay. Icelandic yeah. Netflix, sorry. Shit.
Á hverju einasta árið þann 11. júlí hópast þúsundir mótmælenda á Norður Írlandi í kringum slíkar brennur til þess að minnast sigurs á King William of Orange yfir kaþólska óvin sínum við orustuna við Boyne árið 1690. Og við sjáum augljóslega að þetta mikill fögnuður og hér eru margir að drekka og hafa skemmta sér með buckfast og alls konar öðrum drykkjum. Og greinlega í augum margra mótmælenda hér í þessu landi þá þetta eitthvað sem að þeir vilja minnast ekki bara út af sögunni, heldur líka bara út af skemmtuninni.
Come to Northern Ireland, bye!
Yeah! Jamie Bryson, thank you so much for meeting me. I was thinking on the way over here, like we have bonfires in Iceland a lot. It's mostly just, you know, New Year celebrations, but I mean, yeah. I've never seen one this big.
The volcano?
The volcano, well, of course, I mean, a naturally occurring one. And thankfully the volcanoes don't collapse as they did, you know, just before. Give us a little sense of what's going on here. I mean, what are people celebrating here?
Well, this is the 11th of July celebrations, which every year, on the 11th of July, we build bonfires to celebrate the Battle of the Boyne, 1690.
Right.
When King William defeated King James in the battle, but it's now really become a celebration of the Protestant and Unionist and Loyalist tradition
right.
in Northern Ireland, almost like a night of defiance to show that we're still British, we're still part of the United Kingdom, and, right. and that we haven't been defeated by the IRA's terrorist campaign.
I started thinking when, you know, I was watching the building of it and the lads running up to throw the Irish flag onto the bonfires. I mean, is that an important thing? I mean, if you're just focusing on Northern Irish pride and Northern, you know, loyalist pride in Northern Ireland, why is it important to, throw the tricolours on the flag,
because
on the burn?
The Irish government have consistently been a government which has sought to lay claim to Northern Ireland's territory. I mean, as recently as in relation to the Brexit protocol,
right.
the Irish government threatened IRA bombs for political leverage and continues to demand that Northern Ireland be almost trapped in an economic nightmare. So the Irish government are enemies of the unionist population, are enemies of everybody who values Northern Ireland's place in the union. So, I mean, there'll be many people who have different views on it, but I personally no difficult whatsoever with the burning of tricolours. I mean, you've bonfires all over Northern Ireland tonight,
right.
like 250, I think. In total, like two in this estate alone, plus the kids' ones. So, you know, it's a massive amount of people turn out across the province for these events.
Right. Now, you know, with Sinn Féin taking Stormont in the recent elections, is there more of a feeling amongst the loyalists in Northern Ireland that there is a sort of move against them, or is there sort of a closer move towards any sort of a common ground with the neighbours that live across the sides?
I mean, we're further away from any common ground than ever.
Yeah.
And the whole peace process over the last 25 years, it was designed to incrementally wedge Northern Ireland out of the Union. It was all about,
right.
as I would put it, unionism must give and nationalism must get. And we've nothing left to give. As a matter of fact, we've had nothing left to give long ago. So, you know, there's no compromises for us to make. You know, we have given, given, given over the last 25 years. Given far too much. And we're not giving any more. So, I mean, until the nationalist community recognise that we won't be second-class citizens in our own country, then I don't see any prospect for the maintenance of a peaceful and stable Northern Ireland going forward.
You just mentioned second-class citizens. I mean, looking at the, you know, just from an outsider perspective, when you look at the history throughout it, you know, for example, the status that many Catholics had in cities like Derry, where they weren't able to buy flats, they weren't able to, you know, get jobs. They themselves, during the civil rights movement, felt that they were the second-class citizens, whereas the Protestants were the ones actually in charge. Do the Protestants in Northern Ireland actually feel like they are under threat of becoming second-class citizens?
We are treated as second-class citizens in society in Northern Ireland. I mean, the main institutions of the state, you know, the media, civic society, the law courts, the legal profession, it's all now entirely dominated by the nationalist community. And that's being used to advance that political agenda and to treat unionists as if we are second-class citizens. And now, since the protocol, it's galvanised the unionist and loyalist community when we are taking the position of saying, we've had enough, we're not tolerating any more of this. So, and that, if any one good thing has come out of the protocol, it has galvanised unionist and loyalist resistance.
Ég er sérst núna búinn að finna fullt af ungum norður-írskum einstaklingum sem eru hérna til þess að djamma út kvöldið hérna. En ég verður samt að spyrja þig. So you guys are, you know, can I ask how old are you guys? You're around 18, 19? 19, yeah.
23.
So you guys are, the grandpa of the group, I like
yeah,
it.
Yeah,
so you guys are obviously like born post Good Friday Agreement.
Yes.
You know, one of the things that I've been noticing here since I got here is that there is not a sort of a sentiment amongst some of the older people in this country that with a lot of the youngsters that were born post Good Friday Agreement, they didn't grow up necessarily with the Troubles, but they did grow up with the divides that their parents had.
Yes.
And right now they may be looking at the Troubles like they missed out on Woodstock or something.
Like my dad would have grown up with like the bombing of Bangor and stuff, like when the Main Street got bombed, but he's not very like Protestant, if you know what I mean. Like, we live in Cardo, it's a pretty Protestant area, but he's not very Protestant. Like, he wouldn't really go to bonfires or anything, but
like, he wouldn't involve himself with all the traditions.
It seems like the younger people, there's no fucking like segregation sort of thing between
right.
us. Like, Catholics, Protestants, we're all sort of like
together
now.
Yeah,
everyone's
yeah.
sort of friends. Our generation doesn't really care, but
nobody knows what happened.
Exactly. See, our generation.
What happened is what I'm told.
Our generation won't understand.
No cares.
They don't know what's going on there. Like
anybody who cares, just cares about what the mom and dad have.
So they grow up with the division from their parents, but they don't have the connection, the emotional connection.
That's how their parents screw them up.
That's all it is. Like.
See, personally, I'm Catholic. My dad's from the other side. He's Protestant.
So you're Catholic and you're attending the bonfire.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
A lot of people get mixed up between, a Catholic's a faith, and this is a political stance. What is? I'm Catholic. A lot of people think I should be a part of the Republican, you know, kind of side. But I'd rather be a part of the loyalist side because the United Kingdom is a lot better. You know, you're going to get more, like, better like healthcare and stuff.
So, I mean, is there a sense internally amongst the Protestant communities in Northern Ireland that they feel like they've kind of been left behind by not only Westminster, but Stormont, at, you know, looking at Brexit, looking at the Irish Sea border, the, you know, protocol and everything. And you have so many people in England that, there is a sense that they kind of feel a bit like they've been forgotten.
Yeah, no, I mean, that's a totally fair analysis, but it's been like that for 25 years.
Right.
I mean, unionism and loyalism have been treated like second-class citizens, and you know, that feeling has just gradually spread through the community. You know, you've always had, I mean, in terms of votes for the Belfast Agreement, 48% of the unionist community voted against it even then.
Right.
I mean, now, every mainstream unionist political party has withdrawn support for the Belfast Agreement. All the loyalist organisations have withdrawn support for the Belfast Agreement. So there's practically zero support for the agreement now within the unionist community. And you can't have a stable power sharing arrangement when one part of that arrangement is just feeling as if they don't want to participate in it anymore because it's so imbalanced.
Would any of the Protestants, I mean, you look at, you know, it's obviously, this isn't as simple as just Protestant Catholics. You know,
it's not about religion.
No.
It's about nationality.
I mean, identity, right?
Yeah, it's about identity, but it's not, the conflict in Northern Ireland is not about theology, it's not about religion. It's, you know, people aren't fighting over interpretations of the Bible. It's about nationality, it's about who has the right to govern this part of the United Kingdom. And we're British citizens. So I mean, some of the strongest unionists I know are people from a Catholic tradition.
Yeah, one of the questions I asked, you know, when I first got here was, you know, how many of these people who staunchly identify themselves as Protestant or Catholic actually attend church service on Sundays?
No one.
No, exactly.
Very little. Everyone just has fun.
So then after this, like, even the Protestant, you know, they'll just go back to their Catholic neighbors and co-workers and have a good laugh.
Yeah, everything just kind of goes back.
Everyone's a bit more chill about everything.
Nobody
wants to be angry with each other anymore. It's pointless. I mean, you've got one fucking life, so what's the point being
We celebrate St. Patrick's Day, you know.
Oh, you do?
So what's really the difference in that?
Is there a panacea in place? Is there any scenario in which the two sides could, in a sense, sort of forget the things that divide them and focus a little bit more on the things that unite them?
I don't think so, because I mean the conflict's been on 800 years. Yeah. We've been fighting over this land and fighting for 800 more. So I mean you have two, you know, large majority communities or two sizable minorities, let's put it that way, who each of whom are diametrically opposed as to the very sovereign identity of the state. Now, aye. I don't see how you can ever reconcile those two positions into a workable system.
Just one thing I have before I let you go. After the Good Friday Agreement, there's been, you know, a new generation of youngsters that have been born and don't remember some of the hardships that maybe their parents lived under. Is there a chance that there might be more sort of edging towards violence amongst the youngsters simply because of the fact that they don't have the connection that that their parents do and their grandparents do?
Oh, definitely, there's a definite militancy within young loyalists now who, you know, many young loyalists want to go back to war. Especially over the protocol. Now, I mean, that's not anything anybody wants to see, but there's definitely been a growing militancy amongst the young loyalist community who have seen that we have been treated as second-class citizens, and that's not something which is going to be tolerated or accepted, I would imagine.
What would happen for them, for both sides, to just sort of lay down any sort of prospect for the future of that? I mean, would a South African style truth and reconciliation program work for both sides? Is just sort of
But the political conflict isn't solved. And it can never be solved because unless one side gives up their ultimate objective and aspiration, you know, it can't be solved. And that's the difficulty with it. Also, the difference with South Africa is, you know, South Africa was not about the identity of the state. It was who governed the state. It wasn't about the sovereign identity of it itself. Whereas this is about the sovereign identity of two different nationalities competing.
Þetta er vandamálið. Báðar hliðar verðast líta á sig sem annars flokks íbúa. Norður-írskir sambandsinnar vilja viðhalda breskum áhrifum og breskri stjórn, en stór hluti þeirra sem búa á Englandi spá lítið sem ekkert í stjórnmálum á Norður-Írlandi. Sem skrítið vegna þess að þetta stríð einkendi breska pólitík í nær 3 áratugi. Og þjóðurnisinnar vilja sjá Norður-Írland saminað með nágrönnum sínum fyrir sunnan, en það myndi þýða sundrun á konungsveldinu. Og eftir Brexit vissi enginn hvernig hátta ætti landamærunum á milli Bretlands og Írlands. Baktryggingin, svo að kallaða, lagði til að Norður-Írland og Bretland fengju landamæri við sjóin, en það vilja sambandsinnar ekki því það myndi skilgreinast sem innanlands landamæri. Og þjóðurnisinnjar vilja ekki sjá landamæri á milli Suður-Írlands og Írlands því þá eru þau komin aftur í gömlutímana og enginn veit heldur hvor herinn myndi manna þau svæði. Höfundurinn Marissa McGlinchey sem var tengileiðurinn okkar í Belfast og það í raun henni að þakka að þessi heimildaþáttur var til, skrifaði í bókinni sinni Unfinished Business að Brexit hafi ekki bara endur opnað umræðin landamæri, heldur hafi umræðin einnig mynt fólk á að landamærin eru samkvæmt stjórnarskránni ennþá til staðar. Enginn sammála neitt og enginn veit hver lausnin og eftir því sem árin líða fækkar þeim íbúum sem muna eftir hryllingnum sem skilgreindi stríðsárin og hækkar tala þeirra ungmenna sem hafa alist upp við frið, en frið sem situr óstöður á stórri púðutinni.
Þann 18. apríl 2019 stóð 29 ára gömul fréttakona að nafni Læra McKee á þessu götuhorni þar sem hún var á vettvangi að fylgjast með óerðum sem voru að gerast hér í borginni Derry þann dag. Í miðjum látunum var hún því miður skotin til bana af byssumanni sem stóð hérna niður við götuna. Nýi írski lýðveldisherinn játaði á sig morðið en sögðu að raunverulega skotmark þeirra hafi verið lögreglan og voru einu mistök læru að hún stóð aðeins of nálægt þeim. Dauði Læra McKee ákveðin táknrænn raunveruleiki fyrir Norður-Írland vegna þess að þjóðin svolítið mikið á gattamótum þessa stundina og hvort sem hún beygi átt til friðar eða í átt til fleiri átaka mun svolítið skýrast af þessari spurningu sem eru þessa pólitísku og trúalegu deilur það mikilvægar að stríðandi fylkingar eru tilbúnar að taka upp vopn á ný og drepa ekki bara hvern annan heldur saklis og borgara líka eða einhver leið að ná einhvers konar sáttum þannig að samfélagi einblýni á það sem sameinar það frekar en það sem sundrar það með það að leiðarljósi að fólk eins og Læra McKee geti átt langa og friðsæla ævi í þessu landi. Be thou my wisdom.
true sun. Thou in me dwelling, and I with thee one. Be thou my breastplate.